I've been listening to Claude for a long time.
Too long. I heard a closing opera. Did anyone hear the closing opportunity that Steve Driscoll gave Steve Zobro? Did anyone hear? There was a little. I heard it.
I need to know some more information.
Oh, no, that wasn't it. Anybody pick it up? The referral part? I want to talk. Something about you want to talk to a few people?
Mm-hmm.
Let's go back. Yeah. Let's go back into that first. Let's go.
All righty. Let's go. Go ahead.
Go ahead.
And I'm ready for it. Go ahead. Steve, go ahead.
You know, maybe if you got a few people I could talk to, man, you know, that gave you this $5,000, maybe I'd be a little more comfortable with doing this.
Yep. Awesome. Suppose, Steve, I was able to provide those references to you, let's say, in the next hour or so. And suppose you check my references out and say, hey, man, this guy's a legit guy. He knows what he's doing. You wouldn't want to do some business today if I decide to do that, would you? If you checked them all out?
That would sound good.
Okay. So let me stop what I'm doing right now, Steve. I got a lot going on.
Hold it.
Oh, I'm ready to close him.
Hold it. No. Oh. He said that would sound good.
Oh, I should have said so. What does good mean?
Oh, now we're dissecting, Mike.
See, Steve is really good. Steve is very stealth. I've heard him before. He uses those lovely, that would sound good. What does that mean? Is that a commitment?
Right. No, you got to still get the yes, right.
Steve, when you're getting there. Steve Driscoll, when you say sound good, is that yes, no? I'm a little confused. What do you mean?
I'm still going down the middle. I'm not committing.
Oh, okay. But even if you spoke to five people who vouched for my veracity, my guarantee, my contract, my performance, you asked for it, and you spoke to these people today, and they met with your personal satisfaction, what would happen at 4:30 this afternoon when we followed up?
If that all comes together, we make an agreement. I'm interested. I do it. We're done.
Is that yes? I'm sorry.
Yes, that's a yes.
Oh, thank you. Boom. That's what you need. You got to get up that little micro commitment ladder because guys like Steve are so good at, oh, that sounds really positive. Oh, that sounds good. Oh, I like that idea. That's not a commitment, is it? This is how he's so good at getting out of this. Well, I never said yes, right? So you're going to do all this work. You're going to do all this running around. You're going to send them all this stuff. And boom, what's the next thing we need to do? Once you get a firm commitment, do you have to do a follow-up appointment so that you can monetize this guy at 4:30?
I would close him right then. I would probably say, you know, let me stop what I'm doing right now. It's going to take me maybe an hour to do. If I was able to get you over an agreement by 12 o'clock today, with maybe a 3-minute video explaining the agreement, can you do me a favor? And I would shut up. And then get back by 4:30 with it okay, so I can start working on this for you. And then I would go into that, wait for them to say yes. And then I would say, are you sure you want to do this? I mean, we kind of like, and then I would try to make sure I get that recommitment strong at the end with an are you sure? And then a lot of times what I do though is when I do the video, I'll have a nice little video and I'll put on there right in my video, you have until 4:30 today. So I'm kind of like reconfirming on my little video when I send it to you with the agreement. And I'll say, at 4:31, it's over. I'm going away. I got 10 other people. I'm usually 90%, 100% where I'll get that yes. And I'll have them. They don't come back the next day and say, no, we don't want to do it. So I usually get the commitment, do a little video. In my video, they'll see my face and I'll put in there. And I didn't even send the, see where it says 4:30. And then at 4:31, it's over. And then I get a lot of people. I mean, I'm probably about 80, 90% where people don't have that second thought the next day. They're closed, they're ready to go, and I'm off the races to the next one.
How about I'm sorry, go ahead.
No, that's just how I do it, and I learned a lot of that from Claude, the reciprocity, you know, using that, huge, using that all the time, so.
How about when we go to somebody and say, Steve, what's a good time, after you check all this stuff out, what's a good time for us to speak later today?
Yeah.
See, and that comes back to me, and I'll say, about 5 o'clock.
Okay. Oh, big problem. It's my 5-year-old daughter's birthday party. 5 o'clock is absolutely the best time, right, Steve?
I might be able to do about 4:30 or so. I'll be traveling home by then.
Party starts at 4. I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to change the party around here. I'm sure my wife can call up all the other 20 families and change things. Let me do this. Let's make it 5 o'clock your time. I'll see if I can change some things around with the party. And I mean, you're going to be there at 5 if I go to all this work and trouble, right, Steve?
Yes.
Sorry?
Yes.
Oh, okay. Always sorry. What? Get them to reiterate it. Why? Why is it so important to let them know all the trouble you're going to? You're moving mountains. You don't have to tell them your grandma's, you're changing your daughter's birthday party at the Chuck E. Cheese place or something, but be a little creative. Let them know all the time and trouble you're going to. Why is that guilt so important to impose on poor Steve?
They want to, we want him to know that we're doing something special for him. Something special nobody else is doing. We're going to take our time and do something special for you, Steve. And then, oh, wow. And hopefully he's going to get that same sense that we're doing something special for him.
When you're dealing with someone that's got a lot of experience, that's going back and forth with salespeople and contracts and negotiations all the time, you can be as nonchalant as you want. I didn't say I do it with you. Claude picked that up, right? Guys like me, you got to be a hammer with. That's it. You got to be a hammer.
You got to listen. It's they don't even know they're so good at avoiding commitment. They're so good at it. They subconsciously use the maybe, should, could. Oh, I love the way that sounds. Let's see what happens later on. Possibly some good stuff will, you know, and they'll say these words. They're so good. It's so automated for them manipulating salespeople for information or whatever they want. And
when you come across people that have a lot of business experience or dealing with different levels, all right, you talk to someone who wants to sell a house or lease option a house and it's a $75,000 house. Talk to another person with a house in the same, in 10 miles away, and it's $500,000. Are you going to have the same conversation?
Yeah.
No. And I'm dealing with people all day now that I'm doing lease options, but on businesses. These people are experienced. You got to be a hammer. If you're going to offer an opportunity, if you're going to offer them, you know, salvation, it's now. I'm not jerking around. I'm not calling you tomorrow. What is it? You got to be.